Alfie by Alfie Boe. Read by Andrew Wincott. May 2010. Desperate times. I was exhausted, dispirited, disillusioned. Record deals had come and gone. My solo hopes were fading away. I was 36, and it was time to stop chasing my dreams, to settle down, get a regular wage, and provide a stable life for my family. Still, I wasn't prepared for the blindness and the drowning. I was rehearsing for my stint as the fisherman Nadir in Bizet's opera The Pearl Fishers at the Coliseum in London. The director wanted to film me swimming in a tank for sequences that would be projected during the production. The tank must have been 10 meters deep, and each time to sink low enough to get in front of the camera, I had to dive down and blow all the air out of my body. When I was under for extended periods, I'd been borrowing valves from the divers to breathe in compressed air. If you did that and came up too quickly, you could get the bends. We filmed for 7 hours, and I was sitting in wet, chlorinated clothes all day. The hot water bottles and blankets they were using to try to keep me warm were no match for that soaking costume. Then down I went again, this time for too long. Panicking, swimming frantically to get to the top, I put my thumbs up for the divers to signify I needed them to bring me up. They did, but really slowly, and I swallowed a lot of water. When I finally reached the surface, gagging, spitting, coughing my guts out and absolutely exhausted, the director said, "Do you think we can do it again, Alf? We didn't quite get the right angle and focus." "Yeah, okay, I'll do it. For the sake of art. For the sake of my bills." And I went down again. Finally, I finished the shoot, got showered and changed, and then my eyes started to burn. I needed to get to Stansted Airport to fly to Glasgow for a Scottish opera audition. But when I came out of the studio and the sun hit my eyes, it felt like somebody had jabbed needles into them. I stumbled into a cab, got to the airport, and everything went cloudy. All I could see were tall black shadows moving past me. I was frightened to death. I asked someone for assistance. "Can you help me? I'm having trouble with my eyes, and I need to get through security." He said, "I think you need someone to have a look at you." No, I'll be fine," I said. But my eyes were on fire. The pain was outrageous. I got through security, but the staff sent for a paramedic to look at me. He asked if I'd been diving or swimming, and I told him the story. When he learned that I'd used compressed air, he said, "You can't fly. You could have air bubbles in your blood." They took me off and checked my blood pressure, which was rocketing. My heart was thumping. My skin was red raw. I had a huge blood red rash all over my body. I was shivering and shaking, and my eyes were killing me. They were syringing them with saline to get the chlorine out and feeding me painkillers. I was in a wheelchair. I thought I was dying. I went to Moorfields Eye Hospital. They said the chlorine had burnt my retinas, and they gave me antibiotics. At the time, I was living on my own in a flat borrowed from a friend. It was miserable. I had to lie with pads on my eyes at night, and sometimes during the day, to stop light getting in. Then I caught pneumonia, and was in bed shivering and shaking, coughing and sneezing. And all the English National Opera seemed concerned about was me getting back into the show. I managed to get myself together for the first and second performances, but by the third, the stress was killing my voice. Eventually it went, and I pulled out of 5 performances. I remember sitting in the living room on my own one evening, numb, practically comatose, until 3 a.m. That was me in May 2010. I was so depressed. I was doing various opera gigs, some great, some awful. But my situation with record companies was dead in the water. 3 deals had come and gone, and there were no more doors left to bang on. I was seriously considering other careers that would enable me to settle down in Utah with my family. The only glimmer of hope was this Les Miserables gig I'd signed up to do 5 months later, playing Jean Valjean for the show's 25th anniversary concert. It was a risk. I hadn't done musical theatre before. I wasn't certain it was right for me. It had the potential to destroy my opera career. 1862, when Bizet began work on the Pearlfishers, was the same year Victor Hugo's Les Miserables was published. How odd that that year was to be so instrumental, almost 150 years later, in the life of some bloke from Fleetwood, Lancashire. As a kid in Fleetwood, I spent a lot of time going up to the beach on my bike, riding and riding along the promenade. I used to listen to a lot of 1950s and 60s rock and roll, the Beach Boys, Buddy Holly, Elvis. I'd look out to sea and wish I was in 1950s America. It took me a long time to realise I could sing my way out of Fleetwood. For years, I wanted to be a drummer. I was a drummer. I could say I was born with drum fever. Mum taught me how to drum pretty quickly, with a wooden spoon and a biscuit tin. She taught us all that, all nine of us. I remember belting the heck out of that tin. I could only have been about three. Then one Christmas, she and Dad bought me a tiny little plastic kit with thin cellophane skins and an old tin cymbal. Big time. The first time I ever got on a proper kit was in Blackburn when I was 12. My brother Michael was living there, and one afternoon we went to this music shop and I quickly located the drum department, which consisted of one drum kit. I got on this kit, picked up some sticks and went crazy. The next one I found was in a shop in Cleveley's. I was there with Dad one day and saw this great little white kit in the window. I said, "That's a nice kit, isn't it, Dad?" He said, "Yeah, it's nice, son. You like the drums, don't you?" I said, "Yeah, Dad, I like the drums." I managed to save up some money and buy a pair of sticks from a shop in Blackpool. And in the absence of a kit, I'd sit in my room, drumming on my pillows. One night, Dad shouted, "Alf, come down, you're thumping on the floor and it's driving us crazy." "Sorry, Dad." "Go in the front room. There's something in there that I want you to take up to your room." I went downstairs and opened the door, and there it was, accompanied in my mind by heavenly lights and angels, this white drum kit I'd seen in the shop a few weeks earlier. I never stopped playing it. I didn't have lessons, I just watched other drummers. Then I got together with a couple of guitarists from school, a Mike and a Michael. There was a blues club in Fleetwood on a Friday night. We'd go every week and soak it up. Eventually, we set up a blues band of our own, consisting of rhythm guitar, lead guitar and drums. A guy called Grant played with us on keys sometimes as well. We didn't have a name. Edison's Eye was the next band I was in. The logo was a light bulb. My cousin Derek was the guitarist, and the bass player was an Italian fella called Tom. We were a good little three-piece. We had a nice sound. Then I auditioned for a band in Preston, the English Roses. I saw an advertisement saying they were going on tour and needed a drummer. I set up my little white kit, and they started up a song, and I seemed to fit right in. They offered me the job, but it was a big tour. These guys were 19, 20, I was only 15, I was in school, so I couldn't do it. And I stuck to playing in local Fleetwood bands for a bit. And then I started drumming in the clubs in Blackpool, the cabaret circuit, getting paid to do the backup for whatever woman was singing dodgy Tina Turner covers that night. And by that point, I'd started singing as well. Dad liked to dance. That's how he met my mum, quick-stepping at the Marine Hall in Fleetwood. Like Dad, my mum grew up in Fleetwood. Her parents were Irish, and although they were both gone by the time I turned up, I felt I knew them, because she always talked to me about them. Fleetwood was booming when Mum was a kid. The Marine Hall, where everything that was anything used to go on, was built in 1935. Back then, Fleetwood was a pretty attractive tourist spot. It's not like that now. My parents had the best of it. Saying that, Mum was a really sick kid. She spent most of her teenage years in and out of hospital. Pneumonia was rampant. She had it three times. She was happy, though. despite growing up ill and during the war. Then when her mum died, she had problems with her stepmum and was never really happy again until she met my dad. Me dad, Alf, an errand boy cycling around Fleetwood for the co-op, saw mum walking down the street and fell off his bike, hurtling everyone's vegetables all over the road. Apparently, he said to one of his friends, "I'm going to ask that Patsy Dutton to marry me." And they told him he'd better stay away.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.